and then complained, this was before the Japs had invaded, complained to the Dutch police that his car had been stolen. And the rider had a shrewd idea that the Japs were coming. And they had the police looking for it everywhere. And so it was really registered as lost, stolen, or strayed. You know? And the Japs arrived, the Dutch went for their lives. And then after the war, he had it dug out again. Of course, it was in pretty damp, rusty condition. So the Raja decided to be big about it, and he gave it to the his farmer retainer, who very shrewdly got black market tires and oil and grease and this, that, and the other. And he had about the only working car in Bali, because the Japs had destroyed everything they could, you know. And he made a fortune. And with what he made from that car, he bought trucks. And then he became so rich, so quick, that he was ashamed of the original car. So it was just used as sort of a fowl house, really. And then a friend of mine, an antique dealer, said, like an antique car. Why not? And it was called the Mobile Antique. And we fixed it up, and I used to go around in a lovely car, you know. You sit up in it, you know, nice and tall sort of car. And the engine made a very sincere sort of noise, and you'd go, you know, as fast as 35 miles an hour through the countryside, and peasantry bowing, and you could see the landscape out of it, not like these bloody things they have now.
There's a marvellous bas relief in wood that which shows Mr. Friend at the wheel and 30 of his Balinese boys.
All crammed into it.
All crammed into it.
Yes, that was by a very, very fine wood carver. A young fellow, he was only about 19 or 20 when he did that.
Made Joljol's work was photographed for the cover of The Cosmic Turtle, a collection of fanciful essays. But the bas relief didn't make the transition to Australia. However, the carver's work is represented in the Donald Friend Bali collection. This small chest was made for Donald's personal effects as he was preparing to leave the country. It depicts commissioning the work, presentation of the chest, and the farewell by the household as Donald leaves Bali for the last time in August 1980. This copper sculpture, the Trojan Horse, 1964, marks a period of artistic restlessness. Donald is living in Sydney, but finding a lack of stimulation in his hometown. Trip to Barrel to talk with James Fairfax about the mural he's asked me to paint at Redford Park. 19th of July, 1964. I think there's room for two murals.
And finally, I said I'd like to commission him to do a mural. We'd had a rather boozy night out, several bottles of wine, and he spread it out on the floor and immediately started working on it, and his concentration and sobriety was total as soon as he got to work on it.
7th of September. Work on James's mural studies goes on, and so, of course, do the dinners, luncheons and parties, which I enjoy at the same time.
This is Donald with the lady on the right saying he is so charming and witty, and the one on the left saying, I think he's so brilliant and human. Round the corner, there's Taz Drysdale with one of his landscapes, and Maisie, whom he just married, has the ball and chain round his foot. Sid Nolan has a naked Ned Kelly falling off the back of a camel.
Sid also has a crack right through his head.
Yes, well, that unfortunately is the part of the mild earthquake tremors we have occasionally in this district. Olsen with one of his paintings.
The 18th century notion was that man is a reasonable animal, and Swift said, not at all, that man is an animal who's occasionally reasonable.
He may be reasonable or unreasonable, but you should not be happy and really enjoy. Whilst on the other hand, the whole body of my work is about enjoyment.
It's for that reason often that he's called the wicked Mr. Friend.
I should think so, yes. I said it's not altogether a good thing to enjoy oneself, is it, you know? With Mozartian.
Mm.
He was doing studies on small square pieces of masonite, of various parts of it, but it was very difficult to get the whole concept being the four elements of earth, water on its back, as it were, with its arms encircling the table there, air coming down from the top, and fire with the city of Sydney placed where Donald thought it should be, directly between its legs.
James also commissioned a mural depicting aspects of the Fairfax family history.
It begins in the top right-hand corner with the original Herald building built by great-great-grandfather John Fairfax in the 1850s. That's him in the medallion with the family crest in the other medallion, and the topless lady with her arm around the printing press we refer to as the Muse of Prosperity. We then come down to that greyish house, which is Ginnegalla in Bellevue Hill. It was built by John in the 1850s and was occupied by the family until my great aunt died in 1945. And we used to have the family Christmas lunches there until her death. The cross-section house is a beach house I've got at Bilgola with suggestions of the beach and so on. We then come down to Retford Park with its farm buildings, camellias, parrots and horses. The figure on the left being crowned is my father, who'd completed at that stage his major philosophical work, The Triple Abyss, and he's supposed to be crowned by the Muse of Philosophy. The Fauntleroy figure everyone takes to be young Warwick, although it certainly wasn't my suggestion in the outset. The lady chasing the butterfly is his mother Mary. Then we come down, of course, to the centaurs who are holding up the earth that it's on, and finally down to those Brach-like figures which are clutching the centaurs' tails, and the old bell disc makes a breastplate for each of the figures.
Flight from Egypt is one of Donald's few sculptures. James Fairfax has decided that his dining room is to be exclusively for the art of Donald Friend.
But later on, they got down to this.
A Donald Friend designed tile from Colombo.
And then also down to the extent that they're being commercially produced by a tile manufacturer.
Donald etched the originals in 1960.
Photographs of similar things like
Alan Lloyd, gallery conservator, on his return from an assignment in Sri Lanka, explains to colleague Barry Pierce how the artist contributed much more than his paintings to Sinhalese culture.
Very, very early in the piece. He actually designed them, but as you know from the diary.
With the tiles were garden pots and statues that Donald created while living on the plantation owned by Bevis Bawa, the landscape architect. The shell of Bevis Bawa that Alan Lloyd photographed is cursed with diabetes and totally blind.
And he's sitting in his chair on the veranda of the house. And lo and behold, here he is again, sitting outside, the same chair is still there, but sitting out in the veranda.
It's 30 years earlier.
Yeah, that's right. I always sort of thought Donald Friend as being a person who just did two-dimensional things. But when he reached Sri Lanka, he seemed to branch out in all sorts of different sorts of materials. Maybe it's the influence of Bevis, because Bevis was a landscape architect. amazing thing was there's a drawing in the actual house that Pepper still owns of the actual gateposts. Then you get a similar illustration in the diary that ties up very, very well to the whole thing.
Pretty much like a Renaissance draftsman, isn't it?
A lot of the things I was seeing over there, and I was photographing, Donald was doing the same thing when he was there, but he was catching these little quick sketches, which have got far more movement in them than what I've actually been able to get with my photographs. And then, lo and behold, the gallery's purchased this wonderful sketchbook. And my immediate impression with this whole thing was that it reminded me very, very much of the Hokusai sketchbooks. But the thing that, where this whole thing gelled, was there's a wonderful quote that Donald made about the whole motivation, why he went down to the village and why he drew.
All these sketches are immensely useful, providing my pictures with their lively humours and a great variety of the sort of intimate observations that cannot be invented. Economical and swift as they are, these sketches are not merely impressions of quaint old characters seen by a foreigner and jotted down. They are done with knowledge and understanding. And the gestures, the figures, and costumes I select and define are so expressive that a Singhalese knows immediately that this man is a Mandulati, this a Tamil, this a sweeper, a nationalist, a lawyer, a hawker, a moneylender, a bully, a clerk, or unemployed by his stance, his gesture, the way he ties his sarong, or carries a parcel. It strikes me that this is passing on useless information to art buyers who will have no use for it and never know anyway. But it makes the picture genuine. As now we can immediately guess and make few mistakes about Bruegels or Rowlandsons, Goyas or Hokusai's wayfarers.
It's called
Barry Pierce, Senior Curator of Australian Art at the Art Gallery of New South Wales, with assistance from Amanda Beresford, has fully catalogued the artist's life for the first time.
He thought about his writing very carefully. In fact, the little notebook has the same thing in the diary, but a little bit rougher and, you know, with corrections and little balloons, you know, with inserting a sentence here and there, which then appears in the diary proper as the full written flowing entry.
He was writing those diaries as literature, as much as a private record of his own thoughts. I think he was very much writing them for posterity. Yes. He hoped that one day the great public that he would have would read them.
I have never come to terms with the shadow that periodically falls over my mind and turns everything to bitterness and frustration. To dispel it, I turn, by habit or perhaps instinct, to the illusory warmth to be found in the act of love.
All these diaries, all the contacts, all the friends, all the parties, and superficially you'd think that the man had all the company he wanted and all the fun, but then you realise you pick a thread that goes right back through it, that he's searching for love and companionship.
The large-scale work from Sri Lanka, the city of Gaul, is hung in Australia. Barry Pierce presents it at the Donald Friend Retrospective in 1990. The painting shows the port of Gaul, formerly the centre of the Dutch East India Company in Ceylon. 24 panels in two predellas, celebrating the rich flora, fauna and culture of Ceylon, complete the mural, which was commissioned by the McKinnon Mackenzie Shipping Company of Colombo and painted in 1961. The Australian base between 1957 and 1947 is a small town inland from Sydney, poetically named Hill End.
It was interesting. It was really sort of a kind of definitive Australia, but one that's about extinct now. The people all descended from the old Gold Rush families. The pub was owned by the Eyre family, who'd built it during the Gold Rush. And it was just a village shop and the police station, the pub and post office too, and nothing else. But the landscape was lovely. And great avenues of magnificent trees that had been put in by a man called Halterman. No, not Halterman, his partner, Byers.
who is German from the Black Forest. And he and his partner, Holtermann, found this enormous nugget of gold and became very rich. And Bayer sent back to Black Forest and brought out all of the trees that are in the avenues there. It's marvelous, absolutely lovely, magnificent trees. And, you know, oaks and lime and all of that sort of thing, you know. European. Give the place a strange sort of effect because the background is this eroded red clay soil, tremendously cut about by everybody digging holes in it to find gold.
In 1951, the simple country life is interrupted by winning the Flotolaro Shipping Line's art prize, a trip to Italy and 200,000 lira spending money. It's Donald's second trip to the continent in 2 years. The Italian adventures are legendary. In 1949, he joined South Australian-born Geoffrey Smart on the island of Ischia, off the coast of Naples, where Smart was working in the company of many artists, musicians and poets who gravitated there. Geoffrey Smart became a permanent resident in 1963 and settled in Arezzo, Tuscany, in 1971. It was there that his art dealer, Stuart Purvis, visited and asked about those eventful days on Ischia.
I got there about September 1949. I got a house and I met Artilio, and then Auden turned up that following summer. And I had American artist friends over at Foglio di Ischia, who were also friends of Winston Auden's and Chester Carmen. Donald arrived. I don't know whether he arrived by accident. I can't remember that. I was absolutely broke. Donald always had money, so he was the lucky one. He could afford all the things that we couldn't afford. But Auden had no money, you know, and Chester Carmen had no money. I mean, everybody was poor. But I'm sure we must have all borrowed from Donald. He met Omar Ali, the young Indian, in a hotel in London, and he brought him down. But he was the most fantastic and unlikely sort of person. He was an extraordinary, strange person. He was a prince, I think. Then that didn't work out. And then Donald met Artilio, and I think he fell in love with Artilio. In the evenings, Donald was incessantly drawing, and I remember reading somewhere in an interview where he said, "I'm an artist like a dog's a dog." And I thought how true that is, because Donald would just sit, we'd eat a meal, and then Donald would draw every night, draw all the time, anything, just drew. I think he did it because it's the thing that least bored him. Some of the best drawings are in those diaries, and all the genesis for some of the murals are in the diaries. And they're very, very funny, some of them. And some of them are very, very indecent, of course. Donald believed that everybody did everything for money. And that was the main motive, I think. But, he had the most wonderful sense of humour. And I'm sure that will come out, but I don't think anybody's going to be able to sit down and read all the diaries, because there's far too many of them. It is unfortunate that these are the only diaries, as far as I know, that record all those years of the 50s, 60s and 70s and the 80s. So it'll be just from one person's point of view. There might be others but I don't think anybody else has. So it'll all be the Bible according to Donald, really, and it might not be quite bang on, you know.
You see, I never faked anybody else's work. But when I needed, for some reason or other, an ancient work from some other culture, I'd invent the artist myself who did it. And this thing in Italy, I was living in Florence, and I was terribly broke. And I got a very old panel of wood from a framer who was taking it out of a chest, you see. Had wormholes and all that in it. And I thought, well, I'd really
go through the whole process properly, you know, gesso laid down, all of that, etc., or, you know, going through the whole business of painting it in the manner of those days. And I did a Madonna and Child, and it was about by an hitherto unknown Umbrian artist of sort of around about the 14th century. And the Madonna, you know, was it's severe looking, but, you know, a young mother. And the child she was holding looked like a little bald, stark, naked old stockbroker. You know, that wonderful primitive look that you got in early Renaissance stuff. And she was holding the child like this. Oh, no, in one hand, she had a lily. And there was a scroll round the lily which purported to read Laudate Domine, let us praise the Lord, you see. And very, very Gothic antique sort of letters, you know, entering in a whole smother of wormholes. And actually it read Laudate Donalde. Let us praise the Donald. And so when it was finished, I gave it the kiss of centuries, you know, and hung it over the stove and wiped off the grease and wiped on wax and put it under the rug where people would trip over it, and then you'd restore it, you know. And finally, it really, it grew older and older and older. I'd say about 50 years a day, you know. And I took it to an antique dealer in the Via Tornabuoni, a dealer who had the most marvellous pictures in his window. And quite often, one of them was authentic. And I took this picture into him, and he looked at it, and he looked at me. And I knew that he knew, and he knew that I knew that he knew, and so on. And so he bought it for much more than I could have got for one of my own works, you know. And this was in early spring, and the Americans hadn't arrived. But after a few weeks, it appeared in his window. I used to pass through that street on my way to Peter Kaiser's studio on the other side of the Arno. And it appeared in the most fabulous frame of that period, a really wonderful old frame. My God, you know. It would have beaten any other unknown Umbrian artist of the 14th century that they've painted. And appeared, and then suddenly it disappeared. And so I dropped in to see him one day, and he said, oh, yes, an American gentleman from the Midwest has taken it for his collection. So I thought, good. And I want one day to see it appear in one of those American art books, you know, but it hasn't yet.
Donald leaves Florence mid-1950. I plan to go travelling with this honest rogue Attilio, writes Donald, and he does. The 18-year-old quits Naples, and the pair meet up in London, never a happy city for Donald. They decide to return to Australia, and at Hill End they build an extension to the cottage, Attilio providing most of the labour. After 6 months, the disenchanted Mediterranean packs up and moves to Melbourne, leaving Donald to ponder.
Talking about Italy again, you see, you could go down in, say, Florence, go down to the market, and on the way to the market, you'd pass these incredible masterpieces of architecture and so on, and little corner shrines with most beautiful mural paintings, with lovely statues. And in the market itself, the fountain of the market was by Luca della Robbia, you know, and you'd wash your hands in that, or all the fruiterers, etc., taking jugs of water and all that stuff, you know. Well, you had an environment of great art in the most ordinary activities of your day. And that, of course, has this tremendous effect that Europe is so lucky. They're the last heirs of a very long, ancient, and now extremely decadent family. Whilst here in Australia, what the hell have you got? Only what you and I are making, really. Well, and the poets and musicians and so on as well. But here you get down the street and you say, oh, those beautiful old houses, you know, they're so very old. It's sort of a nonsense. And it has great disadvantages. It has other very great advantages for an artist, because you can walk out of a bush town, and after a few hundred yards, you can feel that your foot has been the first foot that ever trod on that ground. You're the first person there.